There have been very interesting projects that have engaged with the idea of the community in very innovative, interesting ways. In fact, in December last year, we organized a group of grantees to come together, and all of us sort of came together. We discussed ideas of the community. A few of us, Sumona was also part of that discussion. So artistic and cultural practices of various communities, community knowledge systems, and traditional contemporary political and social discourses embedded within specific communities have been at the center of many arts projects that IFA has supported. Practitioners have often drawn strongly on community knowledge, attempted to explore and address questions of community identity and identities, and taken their work back into the community space after spending time working with them and making the work. The projects that we'll see today that are being shared on the, in this panel discussion are representative of the diverse ways in which community engagement in the arts has been prevalent in today. I'd like to, we're very delighted to have our panelists. We have Alakananda Nag, we have Sumona Chakravarty, Ekta Mittal from Mara, and Shomo Shankar Bose. And I will be moderating the panel. Thank you, panelists, for being here with us today. We'll first go with Alakananda. Alakananda is a photographer, and she, with the IFA grant, she undertook a visual exploration of the ideas of attachment and identity, with particular reference to the minority community of the Armenians that are living in Calcutta. And she also did use alternative photography processes to undertake this exploration. So I'll first invite Alakananda to make her presentation.
Thank you. Thank you, Sumana. Thank you so much for being so supportive through the whole thing. And thank you, IFA, that this 9-year-long body of work is finally coming to an end. And thank you all for coming. I'll take you through this book in a bit, but I'll tell you a little bit about it. It's on the Armenian community of Calcutta. And so most of you may not know this, and I didn't either, that we could consider the Armenians as the founders of modern Calcutta. And this kind of lapse in information about the community, these vague things floating in the air, yes, there used to be Armenians, and yes, I think some still live there, you know, that is very prevalent in the city. And that happened mainly because the Armenians left after partition, after independence. And with them left most of them, I mean, most of the information, the research, whatever else there was. But they actually gave the city a lot before they went away. So when I started photographing in 2010, I did it purely out of curiosity. And I wanted to just find out more. The camera gave me a license to walk into a, you know, another world. And after three and a half years of pure documentation, I was actually very, very unhappy with the work. The work itself was doing pretty well. It was showing in a few places in India and overseas. It was featured in the BBC. The Armenians themselves were very, very happy. But I could see that this is not speaking to me of the community. There is a lot more than what I see. And what I realized is that my photographs were brimming with the exotic eye. And that was a bit of a shock to me, you know, this wonder of walking into another world. This was my city. I grew up in Calcutta, and yet there was this, you know, this the photographs were laden with exoticism, which made me very unhappy. And so I decided to stay away from the work and do other things, just retrain my eyes so that this would not happen. So when I went back to it after about a year, I junked all the work from those 3.5 years and I started afresh. And this time the work, I realized, would have to be about the past. But this was a big challenge because there is practically no Armenian left. I mean, there are maybe, you know, you can count them on your fingertips. Also, there is nothing remaining, really, of them. No research material, by and large. So it was a big challenge as to how do I do this work. But I decided to use that to the advantage of the work. and I decided to work with the absence. And so I went into areas of the materials that they were trading in, like shellac, like indigo, the alternate process that Sumana talked about. We used, so shellac was a really important trade item for the Armenians. It was a very important material for in the 19th century. And I did this alternate process. So if you see the cover of the book, if you haven't seen the book, I would request you all to see it. It's on view on top, because there's a certain tactility about the book. And it's a very small, it's a very silent book echoing the community also. So yeah, please go and have a look. So, 1 minute. So I was talking about shellac. Then I wanted to use indigo, but there was no indigo, because when I went to the Armenian street, which is ironically a street of dyes, and I kept looking for indigo, they said, we don't sell indigo anymore, we just sell blue dye. So I actually photographed blue dye, you know? So things of that nature. So I kind of was having, by then I realized that this has to become a part of the work. There were some scattered journals here and there, a few books, and of course, then I used my photographs, some negatives, and I started writing, which I didn't think I would do. I didn't think I had it in me. So if you see the writing here, it's very haiku, as little as possible, but I think I'm changing that. So also from this dummy phase, I didn't choose to sort of print it immediately, because again, if you're talking about representation, you know, the weight of that representation, because you know, I'm not an Armenian. I am, yes, I'm from the city, of course, but how does one represent this community? You know, what am I searching for? How am I, if this book is going to become an important book, and of course a book is, you know, pretty permanent, then I think for me that weight was quite a lot. So that also sort of added in the time frame that I was taking. So I will take you through this, and you'll see that it's a coming together of different kinds of imagery. So there are photographs taken by me, there are negatives, there is archival photographs of one family only who have, you know, retained their album, nobody else has. So I only used that material. And of course there's writing, but in a way becoming like memory itself, fragmented, some things are, you know, clear, some are not. So let's take you through the book quickly. So this is the cover, and this image here is the image that we did the alternate process with in the only studio in India which is doing alternate 19th century process. And the book is in three parts: book of attachment, book of time, book of detachment. So again, this is a very interesting photograph for me, because in my interaction with the community, the purity of blood is very, very important, because there are such few Armenians left. They are not very, you know, there are some intermarriages, but purity of blood is paramount. And there is no pure blood as such, really. So this is actually just photocolor, which I have photographed. So on the left is souvenir again. So a few years ago, somebody actually destroyed all the old books in the library of the Armenian school. And this is the only book I actually found that I have now used quite widely in the final edition. But this is the cover of the book. So this is the blue dye that I was talking about. And then I have this kind of text sort of flowing through the work just to guide the readers through it. This is in the Armenian street. If you see, it says there. So this is a gramophone record. Now for this, for the dummy version, I had not found the actual gramophone. This is recorded by Gauhar Jan. So this is actually a screenshot which I used for the book. But I'm very, very happy that I finally found a collector and I have now photographed the original. So Gauhar Jan was an Armenian and she was also the first Indian slash Armenian, obviously, of origin, who recorded on a shellac record. And this is that one. So there are many interesting histories. Like the negative here you see is on the rooftop of Queen's Mansion. Queen's Mansion is an iconic building in Calcutta on Park Street. And it was built originally by an Armenian called Johannes Karapet Galston. And he was a big time race, whatever, horse owner. And he was very famous. And legend goes that in the races, he lost all his money. And then somebody had to buy this building, and that's when they called it Queen's Mansion. And the Armenian club, interestingly, is housed in the same building. That's the choir in the Armenian school. So this school is very interesting. I don't know how many of you have been to Calcutta, but there is a street called Free School Street. And the reason it's called Free School Street is because the Armenian school for 200 years now has been a free school. So they had a very, very big presence in the city. And even today, kids from Armenia, Iran, Iraq come there and they study for free. So this is a very interesting thing I came across in my research, which in the final book is actually going to go at the top. I'll just quickly read it. So this is an epitaph of Calcutta's oldest Christian grave. This is the tomb of Riza Bibe, the wife of the late charitable Sukhyas, who departed from this world to life eternal on the 21st day of Naka in the year 15, i.e. on 21st July 1630. So this is this article, what this person writes in the end, is that what a world of questions is suggested by this newly found record. Why was this source of information never utilized before? Who was a charitable Sukhyas? And how did his family come to be living in Calcutta 60 years before the advent of the English? Was there already an Armenian settlement here? So this question is actually very interesting because if you look at the year 1630, it is 60 years before Job Chanak came to Calcutta. He came to Calcutta in 1690, which is why there is actually a very big possibility that the Armenians could be considered the founders of modern Calcutta. So I use the idea of time as well in this book because when I interact with the community, I see there is this attachment to their glory. And there is this, you know, they're not here, they are there because that is what they are really, really proud of. And so time, I'm questioning time because when we are looking at time, and I ask this question at the end of the book, that if we think of the past, it exists. So, you know, how do we perceive time? So I just brought in this chapter. This is my... So this is a very interesting photograph. This is the oldest existing rugby photograph from 1936, which I photographed in the school. They have it, but they wouldn't allow me to take it out of the frame. So I actually photographed this with the frame, with the glass and everything. So this is the grave that I was talking about. This is the tomb of Riza Bibe on the left. So this is shellac. And shellac is something that I kind of really got hooked on to. because of the insect. So here I was looking at this community which was so attached to, okay, almost there, which was so attached, which is so attached to, you know, what was and the glory. And then this material which brought about the chunk of their wealth is actually produced by a tiny insect called Lacephalaca. And their entire life cycle is very interesting. I will read that right at the end very quickly. it's called the Feast of Death. And that kind of typifies detachment for me. And I kind of started wondering, you know, like, have we missed the point? Like, would we consider the Armenians to be like the messengers of the Laka? And how are we dealing with this sort of extreme polarities? So that's why I have used shellac quite widely in the book, including the cover. This I photographed many years ago, the 191, which was the 191st anniversary of the school. And of course, it's changed so much by 200 years almost now. That again is a negative of Gauhar Jan. But I'm not going to use this photo in the final book, you know, Sumana. I have found the only photograph from this collector that her only disciple gifted to him. So that's what I'm going to use in the final book. Can I quickly read this? Do you mind? I have time, 1 minute. Okay, great. So I'll quickly read the life cycle of the lacquer, and then I think you will understand why it's such a stark contrast to the attachment that we're talking about. So in the 3 months life cycle, the female insect starts building the cocoon from the moment it's born. In its three cycles of shedding, it starts losing external organs, wings, legs, finally left with just the mouth, laying eggs inside the hard shell. The larvae swarm the branches of the host trees. They feed off the tree. Hypodermic glands secrete a semi-liquid resin. When this comes in contact with air, it solidifies. Once the larvae are ready to hatch, the female lacquer dies. The male, on the other hand, lives for 4 days. In its process of metamorphosis, it loses its mouth. It copulates with over 40 female insects and then dies, concluding the Feast of Death. And this again is like the negative of that blood, and I've written this little poem to end it. Yeah, and that's the book. I also wanted to share a newer version of the edit, but I don't think I will do that now. But I do request you all to go and see the book on top, because I think then it'll make sense. There's also an essay at the end of the book, so I think if you read it, it perhaps will make more sense. Thank you.
Thanks, Alaka. We will have Sumona Chakravarty next. Sumona worked on this project called Chitpur Local, and IFA supported two editions of Chitpur Local, which is based in one of the oldest neighborhoods of Calcutta, Chitpur. And one of the key aims of this project, Chitpur Local.
Thank you all so much for being here. I am here representing Hamdasti, an organization that works with community art practices in Kolkata. And, you know, a bunch of us got this grant together over 2 years. So I'm just, one of the many who have worked on this project. Chitpur Local is one of the first projects that we started as Hamdasti. And the idea was to see how artists could engage long-term with different community spaces and activate them as spaces, as shared cultural spaces. There's a lot of history about why we chose Chitpur and how it already had a history of these practices, but I won't really go into that because at this presentation I'm trying not to look so much about at the context, but also the process that that we use and delve deeper into that, so we can then, in the panel discussion, address more critically like all the challenges of working in public spaces, in communities, engaging publics. So Chitpur Local, under Chitpur Local, there are about three projects in the first phase, which was in 2015, and then seven projects in the second phase, with different artists coming together, some of them continuing over the two phases, to engage with diverse communities, context, spaces at Chitpur. Sometimes the space had a specific community attached to it, like say the Oriental Seminary School, which was our starting point, and the students and the teachers there, and sometimes not. They were more open public spaces, and we were trying to build communities around them. Just to acknowledge that sometimes when we are working in these tiny lanes and in people's homes with 20 people, 30 people, you sometimes wonder, especially given a day like today, when there are forces at play to reorganize fault lines, reshape hierarchies, reorganize power structures with what's happening in Kashmir, or as we heard in the morning with Aku from Manipur, that you feel like what are our little kind of manipulations and protests and subversions really in the scope of all of this. But here we are in a sort of end of a narrow lane in Kolkata and Chitpur. And this was the pop-up museum which one of our artists, Varshita, had created. So what does it mean to really place art in communities? Is it just about creating an artwork and putting it there? Or is it about testing these fault lines, these hierarchies, the prevalent narratives, the friction, the points of friction, the points of engagement, the knots and the tense moments and spaces? So was it really just the act of collecting these objects and putting it in this space? Or was it the process around it, the conversations that happen around it, and what it challenged? For example, in the pop-up museum, there was a Jatra costume. So we are connecting to Shomo's talk later. But Jatra costumes, along with very old antique objects from a house in the area. And there was a kind of discussion and dialogue between the contributors of the two objects of what should be worthy in the museum. So the person who owned the antique objects was saying, these are all like cheap materials. It's not ancient. It's not old enough. While the person who was, creating the Jatra costume, for him, it was a treasured kind of a treasured part of his identity and history. So it wasn't really about just placing it here, but who collected it, who put the stories together, how it was put together, what clashes and contestations happened in the process. Today I wanted to talk about just one project and go into it in greater depth. So like the pop-up museum, which was done by Varshita, there was a project called Jora Bagan Encounters, which I facilitated in the second edition. This was at the Jora Bagan traffic guard, the police station in the area. Once again, when this became our point of entry, and we were allowed to enter this space because the police in the first edition of Chitpur Local really enjoyed the performance of the children of the Oriental Seminary School, and they said, okay, fine, why don't you come and talk to us and see what we can do. In fact, it wasn't they, it was just one person. It was the officer in charge of this traffic guard, who was very open to the idea of, artists working with them. And this was our entry point. So as soon as we're entering, I guess, again, the questions are, what are the fault lines? What are the hierarchies? What are the contestations? What are the knots and moments of tension? And that's kind of becomes the beginning. For a lot of people, they thought we were doing this project because it's a beautiful heritage building. It is. But for us, it was more these structures and dynamics that were interesting interesting fodder almost for the project, or interesting things to explore. So this is Alok Shanna, and we had an instant connection. He's a police officer who has Rabindra Sangeet as his collar tune, he didn't really have any questions about why should artists work in the police station. He was happy to do anything. Dance performance, yes. Music show, yes. Do anything. Anything, I will support you. I will take you to Bada Babu. So, these are the relations that he then helped me understand. The Bada Babu, and then him, and then his sergeant, and the very strict hierarchies that are existing at a police station. And initially I thought, for me, if I look at my practice or our practice as Hamdasiyas, testing and pushing and tweaking these fault lines, maybe it's just enough to do a concert at the police station. And maybe it's enough to make sure the OC sits on the ground and the sergeant sit on the top. And just, that would be enough. Enough of a push, enough of a move and a shift. And so I was very happy with this understanding of the relations and what he wanted to do. But of course, Bada Babu had very different ideas. So when I went to Bada Babu, he said, very good. Mr. Shanal has said very good things. You all must do a project, but it has to educate people about traffic rules. So I was like, oh, okay, now am I going to sell myself out, or, you know, what's going to happen? Am I going to become a mouthpiece? Yeah, and that, and yes, I know, that's what ended up kind of happening. So what I did was I spent many months, of course, reading through the kind of paperwork and all of that, but also just spending time at the thana, walking in and out whenever I please, which was a very different experience of what I had experienced before in a police station, sometimes I was let to be on my own when I would just then sneak in and have conversations with different people, sneak into the kitchen. Once they left me in their training room with their computer with all their personal pictures of their adda sessions after work and all kinds of things like that. Other times it was very controlled. So who is the community and who I had access to was very fixed, where Mr. Shanal recommended his 5 top officers and, you know, his best and favorite officers to engage, be the official kind of representations of the project. And in the meanwhile, I was working through the permissions. So here I was at the end of about 4 months, I think, of this process, wondering what I would do and how I would respond to this space. So again, their role is like literally they sign the paper. So the next time we do it, hopefully their role will be even more. But that was itself another sort of fault line being tested and another step in changing the kind of relationships and dynamics. So this time, I'm not doing it anymore. There's an artist called Shinjita Roy who's a dancer and an architect. She is, she started something called the Road Crossers Club, where they do a meet up at the police station and devise a performance for the traffic signal. And she's done one edition of this, where slowly again you can see how she tried to get the cops to be involved in this performance. They were involved again, they gave us the permission, they made sure that we could do the performance and all of that. But during the workshop at Alakananda, so they were giving us phrases we could use for the performance. So this was the first baby step, and the next workshop, which is next week, hopefully they will be part of the performance as well. So you can watch this on YouTube. I'll pause for now, and you can just search Road Crossers Club, and the video of the first performance is there. Okay. Yep. So thank you so much.
Thank you, Sumona. We'll now have Shomo Shankar Bose. Shomo is a photographer, and he will be talking about two projects that IFA supported in the idea of the community that emerges very differently in both these projects. One is a photography project he undertook of the Jatra artists, not so much to document the Jatra, but actually to understand what the relationship that is that the Jatra artists have with the characters they are playing was one of the aims of documenting this. And the other project is what he's currently working on. It focuses on this controversial episode of the massacre of the Marid Chapi that happened in 1979. And Shoma will talk about the idea of the community that that emerges from both these projects.
Good evening, everyone. Today I'm going to talk about two projects of mine, and both is supported by IFA. The first project, Let's Sing an Old Song. This project actually was my first project and also supported by IFA. I really like to give like for all the time, I really give to thanks to IFA, because when I started this project, so I just completed my education from Pathshala. I came here without having any portfolio or any kind of other support. So IFA believed on me and gave me like support to complete this project. And after this project, then I start doing the other projects. But this is like, I always say that without supporting IFA, it was impossible for me, like where I'm standing now, after like 6-7 years in my photographic journey. Okay, so this project is about retired Jatra artist. I started this project in 2012 or 2013. I think in 2012. One of my uncle actually got retired from Jatra because there is not enough money in this art form, and that is why he left. Can you hear me? Okay, no. Usually I love to speak like a little lower voice so people can sleep, you know, because usually my presentation is boring enough. And so, my uncle, yeah, right. So, uncle left Jatra and started doing work in a railway workshop. And I was talking with him because I have a good memory about Jatra, and my family people are from Jatra, they acted in Jatra. So I thought, like, why not meeting the all really old artists who are retired and who have a very heroic journey in this art form. And I start meeting with those people and converse with them, and then after like months or sometime after years, I start shooting this project. So I'm going very quickly because this project is already I'm exhibiting in second floor. So if you're not bored enough after showing my work, then you can go and have time there. Then I will be also there so you can ask me from this project. So I'm just going, he's my uncle. He's two person who is almost 70 years old and playing the newly married couple who actually did the same character in 1960-65. So in few pictures, this is not only the portraits I did, like definitely the majority of this work is the portraits, but then this is a house like where the Jatra artist used to do the rehearsal, and it's closed from 1990. So I just took a picture of that rehearsal house because it was closed, so I can't enter that house. And this picture is from Sundarbon. He used to play the character of deer, and he's very shy, like he don't want to show his face because like he always played the animal character. He said like, what people will say when they will know that I only play animal characters. And I'm okay, fine, so we can shoot like this. He used to play the character of Sri Chaitanya. So also I archived many pictures, though most of the time don't use these archives, but I took inspiration from those archives, like how was their life, because when I brought up, mostly the Jatra, like the culture of Jatra died, like I'm not like it's died, but it's like start vanishing already. So I start collecting all the old archives so that I can understand like how was their journey as Jatra artist. This is another picture I found from one Jatra artist. So the main Jatra producer died, and they took a inter-group picture of the dead producer. And which is funny, like some people are smiling in this picture, like they're so much happy like the producer died. I don't know why. And some people are crying. I'm like, what kind of, this is a very interesting memory, like I don't know, like. Is my own grand uncle. He died in 2015. He used to play a character from Othello, and now he's running a studio, small studio in Durgapur. So I don't know why not take a picture in his own studio. This is a very interesting picture. So I heard about this artist named Manjuri Devi, and she used to live in a place named Keshiari, which is near the Bengal and Odisha border. So I went there and I heard that the artist died like a few months back. So her husband told me like this is the only thing, because they moved out the house after she died. So it's like the only thing I had the X-ray copy of her. So you can maybe bring if you want, and like, why not, like, most of the time, I know the artist from outside. Like, this is the one picture I have, which is from inside. I never know, and nobody will know that how the artist was looked like, but this quite interesting. It's a Bela Sharka, like, people knew her as the Shuchitra Shen of Jatra. So this is the first project I did, and then there's other projects, but as because it's a idea about the communities and how I engage the community. So there's a project about a massacre happened in Sundarban area named Mori Jhapi. Now its name is Henry Island. So the project name is Where the Birds Never Sing. The massacre happened in 1979 and on the Bangladeshi refugees by that time government in West Bengal. So, but still, like my other project, this project is not exactly about massacre. Like my Jatra project is also not about Jatra, it's also about the people, the old people who are remembering their old past. They are like every person has their own heroic story. So this project is like, I traveled, this project has two different layers. One, I shoot in Sundarban areas, and another one is actually I tracked down all the people who survived the massacre. So I met them, I listened to the stories, and depending on those stories, I made picture in Sundarban area. So few pictures are like I created the dreams, I created the desire, not desire, like I created the dreams, like they're still coming in last 40 years. Or I created something which they still memorize after 40 years. For Jatra, I think that is a project about a community, about their heroic past, and this is a project about a community, about their very sad past, like the kind of memory they want to, they don't want to remember again. So when he was staying in Mori Jhapi area, so there was like very few profession they had. Like one is fishing and there's another one is like collecting honey and all. So when he went to collect honey, so there's a tiger attack, and there's a mark is still there. So many people say to me like they waited for their wife and their husband on the opposite island when the attack happened, and they, like every night or every morning, they waited for months and before they leaving Sundarban, they said like they're waiting for hours that their husband or their wife or their kid will come. But most of the cases, like they never came. So from that idea, I made this picture. And so one of the survivor. So this is the last picture from this edit. So I think for me, like, we still have 5 minutes more, so I can speak anything. So mainly my, all the project is always about the past, the memories, and from the particular people where some link I have personally, like the Jatra, like they used to like act, my family people actually acted in Jatra. This project, Mori Jhapi, because my family also had a history from coming from Bangladesh and struggling their first generation and second generation in India. Now I'm the third generation Indian. So what I try to do, like I always try to find a link from myself or my stories or my people's story, and then I spent like 1 year, 2 year, 3 year, like I did a long research before starting each and every project of mine, and then I start communicating with them. And so when I'm talking about a community, actually I'm also talking about me or my stories or my family stories or my people's stories, because every person does not belong from a particular community. Everyone has a different kind of layer. Like I'm a Bengali, but I'm not Goti. I'm Bangladeshi, so it's not, I'm not upper caste. Also, like I have a background in Jatra. So if we figure out, like if we have every layers, and every layer has a different kind of community we have. Like it's very simple. Like some people are Chelsea followers, some people are personal follower. But Chelsea follower also have a Mohunbagan follower, and also have East Bengal follower. I think like those things in myself, I try to like concentrate more in my project. And yeah, that is how I do. Thank you. Still, I have 4 minutes.
Shomo. The last discussant for this evening will be Ekta Mittal, who's representing Mara. Ekta is the co-founder of Mara, which is an arts and media collective based in Bangalore. IFA supported them to undertake a project where 8 performer facilitators went on a train journey covering almost 10,000 kilometers across the country, engaging with diverse communities, exploring perspectives on identities. Ekta was the principal practitioner on this project was Anish Victor, and Anish is not here, but Ekta and Nihal will jointly present it for us today.
Thank you, Sumana, and thank you all for being here to listen to our very long story, a very long journey. Before starting, I want to start with a poem. So it will probably tell you a little bit about our journey. He is quiet, and so am I. He sips tea with lemon while I drink coffee. That's the difference between us. Like me, he wears a white striped shirt, and like him, I read the evening paper. He doesn't see my secret glance. I don't see his secret glance. He's quiet, and so am I. He asks the waiter something. I ask the waiter something. A black cat walks between us. I feel the midnight of its fur, and he feels the midnight of its fur. I don't say to him, the sky today is clear and blue. He doesn't say to me, the sky today is clear. He's watched and the one watching, and I'm watched and the one watching. I move my left foot, he moves his right foot. I hum the melody of a song, and he hums the melody of a similar song. Yeah. I wonder, is he the mirror in which I see myself, and turn to look into his eyes, but I don't see him. I hurry from the cafe, I think. Maybe he's a killer, or maybe a passerby who thinks I am a killer. He's afraid, and so am I. This is a poem by Mahmood Darwish, and we will just play a video and then tell you a little bit more about the project.
Thank you.
Yes, so this project called You Are Unreserved was one of the most ambitious projects for Mara to take up. We're a small collective based in Bangalore, and Anish, being a very old friend, kind of proposed this idea to us by stating that for two reasons. One was, I don't know if you all recall that there was this grand exodus of people from Bangalore to the Northeast many years ago. And at that time, there was a lot of tension in Bangalore because it was a moment when everyone was in a moment of fear. And I think that for a lot of us, we didn't know how to look at these images, how to make meaning of it, because we realized we are really distant, actually, from one another. So Anish traced his way back to the Northeast and met a couple of people there and spoke to many people and asked them if they would return to Bangalore. And the response was, one very striking response that came back was, I don't think I'm going to come back because I'm ashamed. And that kind of stayed with him for a really long time. And we talked a lot about this particular moment. And we thought he kind of conceptualized the idea of you are unreserved, which was an idea that was born from various conversations that we had inside the collective. But also we were trying to look at how we could imagine the journey itself as identity. That identity is not fixed, it is in flux, and how we could probably try and not fall into the trap of the single version that is constantly imposed on us at multiple levels, in everyday life, as well as politically and socially and culturally. And this was like a really large dream because we just actually, I think we were dreaming all along. And in the process of that, of course, we ended up inviting various groups to collaborate with us. This could not have happened on our own. So in the process of putting this whole grand idea together, what we wanted to do was work with different people from different parts of the country, travel across the country for almost 30 days on a train journey, and then through interactions with people on the train, try and see if we could kind of make meanings, recognize our conflicts, go deeper inside ourselves, push our boundaries a little bit, and not be too worried about what we were putting out. So we collaborated with four groups in India. One was Inner Space Little Theater in Erangyalakuda. We collaborated with Macbeth Drama in Dhemaji. We collaborated with the name of the school, I forget now, with Help Foundation in Srinagar, and we were the local collaborators in Bangalore. So across these four groups, we ended up kind of requesting them to suggest people who would be interested in traveling on this long journey for a long period of time. So that process itself was again fascinating because we wanted to kind of bring on board one female and one male or any other sexuality, but we were trying to basically try and bring a diverse range of people. And we chose these places because we felt that there were interesting contexts and differences in relation to themes of migration, conflict, and land, the whole question of insider, outsider. So we, in some ways it was random, but in some ways it was also broadly speaking to a range of different issues. So we managed to bring on board various people who wanted to be part of the project. We did auditions. We finally, not auditions, it was more or less like they presented things that we just wanted to know if they would be ready for such a journey because it was about two and a half months that they would be taking this journey. So they came on board and then we went off on the train. And Nihal will tell you a little bit about what happened on the train because he traveled on the train.
Hello, this is Vaughn.
Yeah.
So basically, along the train journey, as Ekta pointed out, the idea was to create interactions with people across along the train journeys in the spaces we occupied, but also to create interactions within the group itself. So, and to try and build and understand this idea of community internally and externally as well. Because at the crux of it, we all came from very, very different locations, four different parts of the country coming together to try and do this. And the binding factor was the project. So the first point at which we came together was at an orientation in Irinyalakuda in Kerala, where we went through a series of exercises which specifically looked at building the building a rapport with each other, understanding where each of us were from, what our own stories were, what our contexts were, whether it was that we came from Kerala, whether we came from Kashmir and the background that that holds, whether it comes the fact that you come from Assam and the background that holds, or being in Bangalore and the background that that holds, and how does that play on our identities. And we did this through games more than anything else, little games that pushed us to share thoughts, ideas, stories, experiences that represent who we were. And the idea was just, that was a starting point, because the entire focus of this journey was, while creating these interactions, it wasn't to try and track what community and identity and all these large words meant to the rest of the country, but more to understand what the interactions with people across this journey meant to each of us. And try to understand how do we internalize that and cause shifts within our own self. So the idea is to try and set a baseline initially. So from there, we went to Bangalore, and then we took a train ride from Bangalore to Assam, which was like 2-3 days. And there were 13, 14 of us shoved in like these little compartments along these trains for like 3-4 days. And this was the first journey. And the way that we sort of structured the conversations that we were having along the journey was that we wanted to try and talk to as many people as possible and try to understand their own ideas about different aspects of identity. I mean, to prepare ourselves, we, the performance facilitators, who were the 8 people from these 4 locations, sort of came up with themes to look at, which were things like gender, one's idea of ambition and work and stuff like that. Very, very generic ideas about like what sort of composes an identity as the spark of the conversations. And around each of these themes, well, what we did was we devised little games and little techniques and little artistic, theatrical sort of ways of sparking conversations with people. So for example, one of the performance facilitators, Sunity, she was very good with arts and crafts, and she built a little paper, what do you call it? Little paper birds and little paper boats and little paper things, and started trying to get people to come and play with them, play with her with these little boats. And this specifically worked very well with younger kids. And then started having conversations with the families and stuff like that around ideas of like where they came from and who they were and stuff like that. But then other things were also come up with a poem. Think of a poem that you have. Think of a poem that sort of reflects your own identity, and then go and share that with someone along the train. And they came up with numerous poems that sort of fit their themes. So there were little games, little songs, little pointers that they would go in and talk to random people across the train and come back and bring the stories to this place where we were sitting to come and interact, to come and reflect on. Sorry, I just thrown off because I have 3 minutes left only. And so that was one way of interaction. The second round of interactions was when we were in the actual spaces itself. So Dhemaji, Srinagar, Irinyalakuda, and Bangalore. And the idea was that we sort of digest whatever experiences we had and try and put them out there in a public space, on a public platform, which included like roads, on the roadside, in like schools, in auditoriums, museums, and built it off the experiences that we had on the trains and the stories. And each show that we had was built off the other and the experiences from before there. And each of these performances sort of were built around the idea of not just being a performance, but performance sharings, where the performance facilitators were aimed at creating a conversation with people around ideas of identity, which would then once again go into the cycle of building back into the reflection and the things that we are putting out again. And then the final sort of sharing would be back within the group, where one would try to reflect on what was happening and then re-put that back into what we were sharing outside again.
I just, I know we have little time. It's difficult for us to just tell everything in 15 minutes because the project itself took like maybe like six or seven phases, and it's still continuing. So we are in the process. So we've done, the fundraising was in a very unique way, because the whole project looked at the spirit of collaboration with a range of different people. So at every step, like from fundraising to the invitation of people into the project, to our collaborators, to the audiences, it's really been very, very diverse. And I think the whole exciting part about Unreserved was it really dreamt, and it really was this large bubble that we kind of built, and we were totally okay for it also to go like that, because Anish's whole point also as a director in the project was not to really take on, to direct from the periphery, not to direct as though he knows everything, and he wanted to really work with the knowledge of what everyone brought in from the interactions on the train, etc. And finally, I think that we were very keen on ensuring that it would be in some ways a gentle refusal of the stereotype, and not to succumb to what was being told to us, to challenge that the dominant discourse, if you could say that. So that's Unreserved, and I think we have another video, but it's a little, it's about 3 minutes?
5 minutes.
It's 5 minutes, okay, we can't show it. So we can show it to you later on, but we can talk more maybe on the panelists. Thank you.
I think first and foremost, what the presentations have done is really break the notion that this community is a homogeneous term. We tend to use it so casually in our everyday conversations, but each of them, like Shomo was saying, community is such a loaded, such a layered term, and it overlaps in different ways. So I'd like to first begin by asking each of the panelists, how did they construct their communities? What did community mean to them? And how did all of you sort of call a certain group that this is my community, or this is the going to be the group or the community that I'm going to work with?
Okay. I think like it's a very difficult question to define, because as a photographer, like I never have to define particularly who is my community or not. Like I always concentrate on the particular incident which somehow is related to all the people I am connecting. So means like I always try to find the one, like if you say the Modichapi incident or the Jatra, so it's the one connection I start to find first, and then I try to, you know, track the entire tree which is related to Jatra. So the people who is related with Chatra, the people who is related with Modi Chapi. Otherwise, it will be like a kind of project which will take like 20, 30 years to finish. So initially, my process is kind of I spent years to do my own research before in touch with them. So I spent like 2-3 years reading everything about them and what is available online or out, like offline or books or anything like I can get. Archives, like in my inspiration, everything I do for like 2-3 years, and then I start slowly connecting with people from this particular incident. But when I'm connecting with this community, I already know 50 to 60% of the story. So it is much easier for me also to convince them that I am particularly want to work on this community and why I am want to do the work on this, because most of the time what I have faced, like the community always asks me why you are doing this project and why it is important for us and not only for you. It's true, like it's always important for me, but it's also, it's my responsibility to tell them that why it is important for them also. So I think like I never define them also as a particular community. I don't believe this boundary of community and any line. I try to speak with them more like kind of, you know, like it's like the simple example I give, like I'm a supporter of Mohan Bagan, you also supporter of Mohan Bagan, let's start speaking about this. Let's start speaking about history of Mohan Bagan. So this is how usually I start. It's not about like particularly I follow the community or anything.
Alaka,
Sumona. I mean, you've said a lot of it already. I would just say, I, in terms of it's kind of, of course, it's related to the space. So I'm looking at the traffic guards, so there's people who occupy that space. And automatically, there are some people who, like I said, the police officers themselves told me you have to talk to these people. So already there are some set hierarchies of who are defined as that community. So what I try to do basically is to try and see what the limit of that defined boundary is and try and take one step beyond that and see if I can include somebody who's perhaps at the periphery of that boundary, and sometimes to my own discomfort as well. Like right now, one of the projects we're doing is, you have to be also very conscious about your own self. And if you're feeling comfortable, then maybe you need to take one more step further, you know? And right now, from the police station, I'm working at a kind of gym, like a gymnasium, like an old kind of men's club, like bodybuilding club. And I'm very uncomfortable in that space. So we're very reluctant to go there. But I guess that's a good thing, you know? So I think in the police station, often I got asked, why didn't I talk to the people on the road or the street kids who they engage with? For that project, I could do this much. But Shinjita is now further testing that boundary because her performance is on the road. Now she's that boundary of who's the community also started including the kids who live there, because if you see the video, they join in at the end in a very organic way, but in a very awkward way. So now she's going to consciously try and reach out to them. So it's always about checking that fault line or checking that boundary and going a step beyond what you're comfortable.
Alaka and Ekta, actually, you both sort of represent the two ends of the spectrum. We attempted to often think that in your case, Alka, the Armenian community is a given community. We attempted to think that this community already exists. But in your project, did you have to sort of, do you see that this community that from the outside a lot of us might imagine as this one continuous set of people, do you see it as a ruptured space? Do you see who are the people that became part of your project? Were the people that were left out? And then Ekta, in your case, it's all a diverse set of people out there. There are people on the train. Just by the fact that all of you are on this one single train journey, you think that you're a community for a limited period of time, and then it's sort of dissipated, and then another community gets formed. So there's a continuous process of making and breaking of communities. So how would you respond to this idea of what a community has meant for both?
So when I started, it really seemed like I'm venturing into this world, which is this other community, about whom I practically knew nothing. But with time, I think, my first interaction with them was in the church. And that is where they all come together. And that's when it all seems like, you know, it's just one family. And their Armenian-ness really sort of comes through, even though 90% of, or I would say 99% of them have never been, and their ancestors have never been to Armenia, but they still speak the language. So it's very sort of... yeah, they're very, very careful about that. But over time, when I started meeting more and more people from the community, there was, I wouldn't say it was ruptured, but there were some who would say, I feel very Indian, I don't speak Armenian, I speak Hindi. And then there were some that would say, oh, I don't know any Bengali because we never wanted to learn the local language. But they are born here. And what was very interesting is, so one time I took somebody to see a Durga Puja. She'd been in, she was a teacher in the school for 8 years, and she had never seen the Durga Puja. And when she saw it, and she was just like, she couldn't believe it. And then this, Mari, who, if you've seen the video, I use her archive mostly in the book. She went to Armenia 2 years ago. I saw it on Facebook, and I gave her a call when she came back, and I said, wow. So do you feel like now you've gone like to your place where you belong? She's like, yeah, I totally belong there and I felt so good. So I said, so then do you think you'll live there? And she said, no, that is not home, this is home. So it's. I think it's a constantly shifting thing for them as well. And so I think for them especially, and you know, they're a diaspora twice removed really, because most of them never really came from Armenia. I think they are in a bit of a, they don't also know themselves. It's home, but it's not home.
I think it's a good continuation in that sense, because it's kind of more or less like, I feel that the entire process when we started off, from the imagining of it even until now,
process of reflection has been very rich. And we realized that I think the impact and the influence that each experience and each interaction with different sets of people across the journey kind of led the people to introspect, come back. There were lots of conflicts, which kind of collectively made us realize that most of the ideas around the idea around community is mostly imagined. It's imagined, and we have to really push ourselves to now think about what we want to do with this imagination, and how are we going to kind of work within this idea of the imagined community. And another thing is that that most of the people from the very beginning, including when Mara met with Anish, from that time until now, I feel that the premise of meeting was already in a space of, it wasn't all homogenous, right? Like, so it's little things like food, language, ways of, notions of cleanliness, ways of sleeping, ways of dressing is fundamentally different in the fact that the group that was together already brought very diverse energies, and to work with that on an everyday basis was the challenge we set ourselves to go. So that already raised this idea of like community, are we really a community? Who is the community? When we are saying community, what does it mean to interact with a geographical community? So there are different ideas of community, and I think we need to probably be more and more open in exploring its contours. And yeah, I don't know, Nihal, you want to add?
I think also the idea of what sort of structures what type of structures mean that community becomes formed? Like, why? What are the premises under which it's formed? For example, this group became a community because we came together for this project. Yeah. And the only reason we stuck together was, one, because of this idea of the project around us. Even when things got super hard and people were super tired, and also because we were on a train together and there was no getting off in the middle of India.
So it's interesting that all of you here occupy a positions that are on this spectrum of the insider and the outsider. Like Shomo could be, because you come from a family of Jatra artists, we don't know, you might be more of an insider, or are you, we don't know, but you are all on this spectrum. And being in the position that each of you are gives you certain advantages and disadvantages. And Sumona, you were talking about these moments of conflict and points of friction. So I'd like to hear from each of you, what have been your moments of friction with communities that you've worked with? What challenges, what risks? Because by virtue of being this insider or outsider that you have been.
I think like both from as an insider or as an outsider, both side has challenges and problems and also has advantages. So like for insider, like I always faced like kind of when you are insider in a particular community, so the community expects more from you because you are meeting them every day and they expect what you are doing. Like you are giving, like most of the time we photographer give wrong promises, and we are doing it for last 150 years that the world will change with our photograph, but we all know that it will not change, it's not changing. So and I think it's most difficult as an insider. And what I realized, like what happened, like as an outsider, what in photographic world, I don't know like about other medium, but in photography what happened, like most of the time the outsider always documented us. Like the white people always came to India and documented us as outsider. And there was kind of a power game. Like they always thought if the white people will shoot someone, then definitely there is a chances to change. But as an insider, for me, when I went back to the villages and start documenting a massacre or start documenting Jatra. Like Jatra was more safe for me because it is a kind of project where like people doesn't have any expectation from me, but from the massacre project there's a huge expectation because they always wanted to tell to media and outside or out the people that what happened. and or what not happen. I'm not sure like what is like how percentage of that oral memories is true or not, and I'm not going there. But the point is, they always expect and they always call me like, what happened with my picture? And now like is a time like you have WhatsApp, Facebook, so they always like send me a link so I can share with my other friends and all. So I think as an insider is most disadvantage I have faced, because they always think like something will happen, and I always feel bad like nothing will happen. And so now what I do, like whenever I talk to any people, I said like, I'm not going to change like anything is true, and what I'm just doing, I'm just trying to archive it. What not happened previously, I'm just trying to archive, so let the future people read about it and then let them decide what happened or not. So yeah, it's like my perspective as an insider or outsider.
So for me, I think that question did not arise because it was just this small community, and I think the conflict for me mostly was internal. And the first three and a half years, as I said before, when I was just documenting, I was very torn because, as I said, I mean, I was, on the one hand, I was so unhappy just purely documenting, but I had just come back from ICP, so the weight of photojournalism was very big, you know, and it took a long time to kind of break free. But after that, after sort of revisiting, you know, taking the year off, and when I was approaching it from... I would say more from the heart and not really, you know, that I have to check all the boxes of I hope I've done photograph everything. I think that definitely has come down, but it hasn't gone, the internal conflict. But at a very tangible level, I think the conflict I faced was with the authoritative powers, really, not with the people. They were wonderful. But every time, like, because it's been 9 years, so the main priest would keep changing and I would have to take permissions, and every time it was quite a bit of a struggle to convince him that I'm not going to take off this. And it took some convincing, often a little frustrating, but I think once they would see... But again, once they saw the final version of the... Not final, the almost final version of the dummy, they were very happy. And of course, with the exhibition... things change. So I think now when I will go back for again a little bit more, I think it will be easier.
Interesting that both Alaka and Shomo, you talked about power. You talked about the power that the artist goes with, whether it's the white man photographing Indians, and now we don't know whether the artist is also going with the same power when he or she goes into the community. And you're talking about the power that a community might have over the artist in terms of participating, in terms of providing material resources, cooperation, all of that. Nonetheless, there is some kind of a power that exists in this relationship. So along with power, we do understand that it also brings in questions of ethics. It brings in questions of authorship. It brings questions of participation and shared knowledge, shared building of a certain creative work. How are these negotiated in your projects?
So I think going back to the idea of power, I think one of the things we spoke even at our last discussion, when we're talking about us inside, outside, it's really not really about looking at inside, outside in that way, but mapping all the structures and relationships and kind of power dynamics in a situation. And you as an artist can move within that at different points of the project in different ways. Sometimes you are at an advantage, sometimes you are the one seeking permission. So I think the idea is to always be conscious of that and to see how to play within that or subvert that or, look at it from different perspectives. So in terms of this ethics of who owns it, I think for a lot of the work that we do, what I was talking about in the presentation as well, this idea of, as artists, when we have the most power is when we have the power of representing someone, like speaking for someone, being able to take away those pictures and put it somewhere else. So for me, I'm always thinking about how do I sort of dissolve or let go of that power of representation, and how do I sort of pass that along? And it's not always easy because a lot of people are not used to speaking for themselves or not used to representing themselves. So how do we create spaces for people to do that. And I think with the police also, like, you know, just involving them in first just interviewing them where I very much have the power to document what they're saying, then playing the interview back and then asking them to record me taking a summary of the interview to them, and then they are saying it in their own words, you know, and recording it back again. Or then they started sharing all their photographs. So how do I then through these kind of iterative interactions transfer that power of representation to people? And in the end, you know, what is left of it? What are the traces that are left of it? And how that also has different resonance and registers. So if I have these pictures, they have it too, but they also have that letter, the certificate from their head office telling them that, oh, you did a great job, you know. So how do different people also have different traces that are left behind and can take it away, take parts of it away with them? Different parts, but nonetheless own different parts of it and take it away with them, I think is, again, just letting go of that power of representation, I think, is often at the crux of these ethics and questions around ownership.
Within the project, Anis specifically said that he's not a director within the project. Creative facilitator, who's a mentor facilitator within this. And the idea was that he's not going to direct and tell people what to do and how to do it and create the pieces based on his own experience and shape it in that way. The entire idea of the performance facilitator is that through the experiences they have, they come together, they reflect and come together and create works that reflect where they are within the journey. And the role of the mentor facilitator is just to help shape it. Now, what's interesting is because of Anisha's experience as within the theatre field, and also the fact that age and a number of other things, there's always, and experience, there's always going to be a level of deference towards that figure within the group. So one can never completely move away from this idea of power, and especially within the role of the director or mentor facilitator or anything like that, there's always going to be some level of hierarchy that exists within it. And I think that's okay. It's about trying to navigate around those structures and creating space for creativity and space for new ideas to come in. And it also helps sometimes for them to be nurtured and to come out in a larger way. The another thing about like the power, maybe not so much in terms of ownership, but in terms of the performance itself, is the insider-outsider question also plays a role there. There was one point where we were in Kashmir, and throughout the project, we were like, yeah, we want to break that wall between us and the audience. We want to engage, we want to push, and completely equal power between us and the audience. We don't want to have that division. But here's the thing, is that it's great when we're in control of it. But the moment the idea that it breaks, that we're not in control and something unexpected happens and someone enters the space that we're occupying, that's when we ourselves sort of created this idea of us being a group and the people entering being the outsider. So you were in Kashmir and someone was talking about religion and they were asked about whether they believe in God. And she was like, no, I don't believe in God. And they were like, why don't you believe in God? She's like, I have my own sort of moral ethics and stuff like that. And it got a little bit heated at that point. And it came with this idea of us versus you and us believing, you're not believing. And then this man stood up in the audience and was like, okay, you guys are like, you are open. You're willing to work with people. You're willing to sit, talk, chat with people, talk to people and like interact. Can I come into your space over there? And he came and he walked, didn't wait for an answer. And then suddenly, everyone in the group, especially all the men, were like, whoa. Chests broadened, people got, and it's like, should we intervene? Should we come in the way? But then he came in, and he took off his shoes, and like put his shoes on next to one of the performance facilitators, and was like, okay, are you willing to walk in my own shoes and put on my shoes? And the performance facilitator was, no, I'm just comfortable in my own. So there was this interesting sort of thing that happened over there, this tension that happened over there, and where the power actually exists within that interaction.
And of course, we do understand that as creative practitioners, there's a lot that you derive from the community. There are resources, there's knowledges, there's a lot of it that has fed into your own practices. But how has your practice or your engagement touched the community? What difference has it made to them? And did they have, like you were saying, Shomo, that they do expect something that when an artist or anybody from the outside is engaging with them. Of course, there's a sense that, okay, something might come out of it. So there's always that expectation. Or it might touch them in different ways. I remember having this conversation with Abul, whose photographs are on display. Abul worked in this little town called Pumpuhar, which is a very interesting town historically. Lots of people who've for centuries lived there. The first thing that when the community came in and they saw the photographs, they said, gosh, we didn't know that all of us from these many ethnicities and colors and, you know, we are all part of this one space here. And then, you know, it's really built a different kind of dynamic within the community, and they've started interacting with each other, delving into their own histories, history of the space, and so on. So it's brought in a lot of change within the community. So whether in whatever ways, how have your projects touched people's lives?
So I think when I started working on this. So there have been a few high points in these 9 years. And it's not like they were expecting anything. You know, they are, people are curious about this community. So through the last couple of decades, there have been some article or the other that somebody writes on an Armenian Christmas or whatever. But I think for me, the first high point with them was when it was published in the BBC. They were very, very happy. But that was when I was really dissatisfied with the work. But that apart, I think when I sort of came across this journal, which I read out, where we could consider the Armenians the founders of modern Calcutta, I think for them that was a real aha moment, and they were very thankful because they were not aware of that, at least the present administration. Then there was this other journal, also in Bengal, past and present, which actually, you know, that. So there was Mir Qasim, who was he was ruling Bengal, and his chief of the army was an Armenian, Gurgin Khan, and he had actually plotted to kill Mir Qasim, and then there was a chance that he could have actually become the emperor of Bengal. So that too was unknown. So there were all these points, but the real coming together, I feel, happened when I previewed the book at the Armenian club. And the Armenians came. I was very nervous, although some of them had seen the work. But I was very nervous because I just didn't know how they would react to it, because it's not a usual documentary kind of work. But it became such a beautiful interaction between the people who had come to see the work and the Armenian community. There was songs that were sung. There were so many questions. They were really, really happy. Yeah, I think for me, I would say if I have been able to find this information and hopefully, you know, have a space somewhere where other people can benefit from it, that'll be great. Because when I started out, it was a real problem, this lacuna of material. And actually, the contribution is so, so large. And then there was nothing really. So I think for me, yeah, I think that was pretty good.
For me, I think it's because I work with like too many people in particular project. Like for Jatra, I worked with more than 100 people. Or in Morijhapi, I worked with more than, like, I have met around 200, 300 people already. And my full moon on a dark night, like mostly my friends, they are like around 150 friends I have to work. So it changes with every person. Like every person has a different kind of expectation. But rather, like, I like to speak about the process than the expectation, because I think this is also coming with the same answer. Like what I believe in my work as an artist, I believe like what I produce or what I make as an like image or as a photograph is not like as just the image. It's rather a souvenir of a particular process. The process between two of us, like we spend weeks or spend months or years together, like with a particular person, and what are we coming from there, that the time? Like a kind of a picture we are making, I always spoke to them for months, that I'm not a person who can change anything or who can do anything because I'm also part of your community too. So that is why I say it, like, I'm also a supporter of Mohun Bagan. So let's like spend the time together and then make something which is like we both togetherly will be happy with it. Like if we go in some place or some city, you always buy a souvenir after like we're leaving the city. We buy the souvenir just to memorize that moment of us. So I think my pictures are the moment of that time we have spent together. And that is how actually I always start conversing with everyone. So, and that is, for me, it's more easier so that people don't expect from me. They expect, but that expectation only we can see in the images also. But not to change anything. Because it's always like people have said, like thousands of that photograph can change. Is this photograph from this area like change? But we can see it's not changing. If there is a change, like, I don't know, like where we are now then. So yeah, like for me it is.
We'll have some questions from the audience. If anybody has questions for them, please. Yes, Lakshmi.
Nice to have a panel on communities and looking at communities more provisionally than communities have been represented in more academic historical discourse. So thank you very much. It was fascinating. I know many of your works. I certainly know the Chitpur work. So it was fascinating for me to get a much closer sense of the way in which you've tried to push the boundaries of defining a community, working with them, and then in a sense sharing ownership, if I might say so. I have a specific set of questions for Alakananda because it's a community that I have some experience with, and therefore my questions would be at two levels. One is, it's a community which has been very extensively studied, both by within themselves, right from M.J. Seth's work, which is old, and subsequently, and there's been fairly rich historical documentation of the community, particularly in India. Because they were such an important community working between empires, you know, from Isfahan, New Julfa to Calcutta, their presence in Madras, their presence in Calcutta. It's a very important community with a very interesting relationship with empires, be it Mughal or be it the British. So in a sense, it's an important community at its crossroads. I also know for a fact that any historical research on the Armenians post 1947 has been especially difficult for all sorts of reasons. We could go on about it later on, maybe privately. So my first question would be, given that you are so invested and kind of fascinating display of the objects that you've looked at, how did you actually build trust with this community? Because, you know, I have had some experience of more contemporary ethnography on the community, and I know, given the fact that they sit on this big trust and there is a huge problem, there are power games, and to get into the community, and I'm not here on insider, outsider, just getting trust to have that rich, thick description, I'm really curious as to how you actually went about building that trust before you got into the objects that speak of this community. So that's my first question. The second question, which is sort of linked, and I was very struck by that display, by that nice red book that you have on the exhibition. And there was one section which talked about Islamic State against Armenians. And I'm very struck by it, and I'd like a little elaboration. Maybe later, but it's something that stayed with me because I know that the genocide narrative is crucial in configuring the identity of the Armenians, whether it is to do with Persia or it's to do with Turkey. Genocide is sort of, that narrative is very important in the configuration of that identity. But with the Islamic State, I'm a little curious as to how you actually reflect on that particular section. So,
about the access, there wasn't a particular point really. Like I said, you know, it was difficult, obviously, to start with, and to negotiate with the church was perhaps the most challenging thing. However, it took, I think, there were various reasons why this work has taken so long, and this was also one of them. There was a point in time when I would go every week, photographing, meeting with them, going to the services, all of that. But there was a point when I wanted to meet with this particular priest, and I was sitting there, I think, for 4 hours, and I was crying because I was like, I do this like so often. They know me. Why are they doing this? You know, it was quite frustrating at times. But then I would break the ice, and then it would happen. And then, you know, before I knew it, the head priest would change, and then somebody else would come, and I would be like, oh my God, it starts all over again. But every time I have been lucky after that initial sort of breaking of the ice. But with the people, it was always much simpler. When I mean people, I mean people who are not from the church. Of course, there were quite a few conspiracy theories, you know, because they have the internal politics, all of that was there. And still, just recently, like 3 months ago, I got to photograph their register of baptism, which exists from early 1900s. And I just wasn't getting access because it is in the church, and that's sacrosanct and it's out of bounds. But I got access to it. Just so it's been a very, very long journey, and it hasn't been very smooth sailing. It has been differing at all times. About your second question, actually that is not related, but that's so in the last chapter where I talk about detachment, and it's got to do a lot to do with, you know, erasure, death, and all of that, rebuilding, you know, all of that. So I came across an article in the Telegraph, actually in the final book, I am probably going to have the article itself, which had this heading, Islamic State Kills Bengal Trade, not the Armenians actually. And it is how the war in Syria had killed the shellac trade. So because in the detachment chapter, I am looking at erasure, I thought of putting that in. Also, I wanted to say one thing more, Lakshmi, about the you know, you spoke about a lot of documentation that has been done as well. But So when I have seen the kind of research that exists outside of India, I was drooling, really, because I was like, I should really have this. But I actually stopped myself, because as I said, when I decided to work with the absence, I kind of went with that. So that's kind of become part of the process.
I just want to share, actually, to Ekta. Your video was very good, actually. Excellent video. And then the entire video had an image of train. And the whole journey, entire journey was properly depicted. And especially one shot I liked the most was the hanging legs. And the train is moving, and the people inside are sleeping, the legs are hanging, and there's an empty seat. So beautifully narrated, actually. So beautiful, actually. I think I'm going to miss that second video because of paucity of time, you could not really play it. But that was a wonderful video. Thank you.
Thank you. The video is made by a person on the journey who documented the whole journey. His name's Varun, and he documented... Sorry, I'm just taking a minute to... because it was also, we were challenging forms of documentation. How are we going to talk about these interactions? How are we going to put it out there without also being truthful to the fact that we don't know everything? So that uncertainty is there in all of our visual documentation as well as our audio documentation. And it's given us a way to think about how do we put our work out, if at all. Thank you, sir.
Right. Thank you very much. Thank you, panelists. We are going to end with that video.
Surbi kafir, tal bi kafir, bangra atan damal bi kafir, Dadar Thumri Bairi Kaffer 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 Kaffer
Kuch gana gana.
इसको कहिए कि इसकी बाप की डेथ कहाँ हुई। इसको कहिए इसके गांव में कैसे लोग मारे गए।
ये आवाज नहीं आनी चाहिए, मैं बता रहा हूँ।
ये नहीं बोलेंगे।
मैं चटपटा खाना चाहता हूँ।